Welcome to episode number 46 of the Mastering Marriage Podcast, where our goal is to strengthen, unite, and restore your marriage. My name is Amanda Taylor, and together with my husband, David, we are the co-founders of MendOurMarriage.com, and our goal is to break the back of divorce by bringing married couples together to be accountable, keep the passion alive, and destroy the hidden issues that try to rip marriages apart. So we are finally back in the booth today with me, of course, Amanda Taylor, and with my homie, my hubby, my hubster.
Yo.
David Taylor.
What's up, y'all? We are back in the booth. And we have a new setup here. We got our new studio together.
Yay.
You know, we got our mic set up, you know, so we kind of...
Not in the closet no more.
You know, yeah, we moved up a little bit. So I was kind of excited about doing it and seeing how it sounds. So we are here. And so we'd like to welcome everybody to episode number 46.
Yeah, yeah.
Of the top ranked marriage mastering. Did I say I messed that up?
You messed it up.
Of the Mastering Marriage Podcast. Welcome, guys. You're in for another juicy treat.
Like that word,
yeah,
juicy.
It was supposed to be juicy nuggets, but you're in for another treat, a show full of juicy nuggets. And this one is going to be good. And this is going to be a show before Christmas. So if you're listening to this anytime before Christmas, we're going to say Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Now, and then we're going to say it again at the end. But first, we would like to say that this show is brought to you on behalf of both my book and Mandy's book, Motivated to Love. And I said I do, but now I don't. You can actually check both of those books out by going to MendOurMarriage.com/books, B-O-O-K-S, books. So MendOurMarriage.com/books to check those out. Yeah, that would be a wonderful gift for anybody that you're looking to help on Christmas. Anyway, guys, you're in for another good show today. And so we're going to dive right in because we got a lot of information to cover. So we work a lot with motivated spouses or what we call standers, right, babe?
Right, right.
Those individuals who are standing for a reluctant spouse, their marriage is struggling right now, and they are struggling to figure out how to stand consistently for a spouse who may not even love them anymore.
Or feel like they don't.
Yeah exactly. Kind of like Mandy and I, right? Mm-hmm. When I was reluctant, Mandy was standing for the marriage, you know, even though I didn't really love her anymore. And so... In doing so, we come across a lot of questions, a lot of questions. And one of the biggest questions that we talk about or that we answer has to do with how to connect or communicate with a reluctant spouse who no longer has an interest in preserving the relationship, right? Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we always share, especially with those that we work with individually through Overflow, which is our program, we talk about speaking to the heart of your spouse and not mm-hmm. to their mind.
Right.
And a lot of people get confused, like, what the heck do you mean by that? What do you mean by speak to the heart and not to the mind? And so we decided to do an episode where we cover that. We cover the gamut. Mm-hmm. And we really break it down and give you guys a lot of tangible tips on how to speak to the heart of your reluctant spouse instead of to their head. So you ready to dive in, baby?
Let's go.
Let's go. All right. So check this out. So trying to connect, understand, and unconditionally love a reluctant spouse is very difficult. Can I get an amen to that?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, that's what I went through. Yeah. When David told me, you know, one day that he felt like he wasn't in love with me anymore. But as time went on, we kind of peeled back the layers and we saw that it wasn't about me at all.
Yeah, yeah. And so, and that's difficult, right? To feel like I'm loving someone who, right, is not even... I guess, wanting to receive my love,
mm-hmm.
worthy of my love. I don't know however you want to put it, but that's difficult. So difficult that you often find yourself, if you're not careful, becoming reluctant and, you know, finding yourself kind of doubting and even feeling discouraged regarding your stand. And so in trying to understand your reluctant spouse, there are a few things that you have to remember, and not just remember for one day, but I mean like, truly rehearse and make this, as Mandy would say, a lifestyle. Like, keep this stuff at the top of your mind. Because let's say you're standing for a spouse and it gets rough, it's easy for you to forget about the things that, you know, the tools and the tips and the resources that you have. Because you can get so lost in the stand and so discouraged that you fall on old ways of thinking.
Right.
And so you got to keep this stuff at the top of your mind, like literally rehearse it every day for real. And so in trying to understand your reluctant spouse, there are a few things that you have to remember. Okay. And like I said, you just keep this at the top of your mind, rehearse it every day. Forgetting these things will leave you feeling defeated, depressed, deflated. Mm-hmm. I promise. Okay. So let me give you some things real quick regarding what you should remember before we dive even deeper into this. So here's a couple things you need to remember. Remember that your spouse is driven by the need to be safe and secure. That means that they're going to do things that's self-preserving. Mm-hmm. You may call it selfish, whatever term you want to use, but they're driven by the need to protect themselves. Okay?
Which again, usually stems from their past.
Exactly. We'll get there. Mandy's always jumping ahead. That's all good, though. Remember also, your reluctant spouse is reluctant for a reason that usually has its origins in their past, mm-hmm. like Manny just said. What that means is that you are not the problem. You cannot own their issues. I'm going to say this again. You are not the problem. You are not the source of their pain. Their reluctant position is not your fault. Right. Say that with me, okay? It's not your fault.
It's not your fault.
It's not your fault, okay? They're lost and confused. Remember that. This means that they won't be able to be an emotional support for you during this season. And they will communicate in a manner that is irrational and illogical. So you cannot buy into what they say all the time. You cannot put all of your emotional, like, open yourself up emotionally when they say something because they're irrational and illogical because they're reluctant. So just remember that, okay? Also, remember, stop expecting them to communicate with you in the same manner that they did when the marriage was not failing. Okay? You have to decrease your expectations. I don't mean lower your standards. Mm-hmm. I mean erase those high expectations for them to come in one day and get this epiphany. Like, mm-hmm. change that and be realistic about the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Meet them where they are so that you're not disappointed.
Right.
Okay? If you expect anything different, then you're setting yourself up for a boatload of frustration and disappointment. I promise. We see this a lot, right, baby? We work with people literally daily now, one-on-one, and we always have to remind them, have the right level of expectations.
Right.
Yeah, so just remember that. Also, remember this. Their primary aim is to protect themselves. Like I said, the first point, their primary aim is to protect themselves. They will say and do things that are very self-serving and self-preserving, mm-hmm. okay? Remember, they're not thinking about protecting the family or you. They're thinking about protecting themselves,
right?
Okay? So just remember, they're going to do things that are self-preserving and self-serving, okay? Also, they won't be able to love you unconditionally during this season. Don't expect them to act as if they do,
mm-hmm.
okay? Remember, I said have the proper level of expectations because don't expect them to love you unconditionally if they don't even know how to demonstrate unconditional love. Okay? What you got to say to that, baby?
Oh, well, what I just keep thinking with each and every point, please don't think that you can do this in your own strength. And mm-hmm. I know we're probably going to talk about this a little bit later, but this has to be a God thing. You have to do this with total dependence on God and doing it through his strength.
Yeah, that's good. Good stuff. So in order to connect with them properly, you have to keep these things top of mind. You can't communicate with them without looking through those lenses. This is very important, okay? So please, before we move forward, remember those things, okay? And if you need to rewind it and write those things down, I actually recommend doing that. You have to keep that at the top of your mind. Elsewise, you're going to find yourself very discouraged. You're going to feel like your faith is fleeting and you're going to feel like giving up. And eventually, you're going to find yourself being reluctant just like them. Okay.
Right. And you have to look at them like God looks at them. But of course, you have to build that relationship with God for yourself before you can even be a light and example of God to your spouse.
Yeah, that's good. And remember, as they are defensive and self-preserving during the season, you will have to get real good at communicating in a manner that disarms them.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you remember at the top, I talked about speaking to the heart and not to the head. You got to get really good at disarming them. And right. So we're going to give you some strategies because most people struggle with this. if you trigger them, expect to be rejected, right? You have to know this. Elsewise, you'll find yourself reacting defensively to their defensive attempts, okay? Again, I've said this before. You have to speak to their hearts and not to their heads.
Right.
So what in the heck does that mean? Okay. So again, I'm going to break this down for you. So this is just a fancy saying of saying it this way. It's actually a concept that works consistently and is one of the hallmarks of standing with unconditional love. And so when I say speak to their hearts, this is what I mean. I mean to read between the lines, to listen beneath the surface to what they're truly saying. Okay. Okay. You guys know I'm a mental health counselor. So I've been in the psychology field for the last 12 years plus of my life. And so I'm about to give you a principal concept that psychologists have found is at the core of human behavior. And some of you guys may already know this. Some of you guys may not, but here's the core concept. Most people believe that human behavior is motivated by how we feel, but that's only part of the truth. On a much deeper level, human behavior is guided by how we think and by what we think. Actually, this is how it works. Thoughts, like things that you have inside of your head, lead to your feelings, and your feelings lead to your behaviors. So in order to change a person's behaviors, let's say a reluctant spouse's reluctant behavior, you can't just focus on their emotions. You have to focus on the way that they think, and you have to help them change the way that they think, change the way that they perceive certain things. On the flip side, in order to understand a person's behaviors, you have to understand their thought patterns. What do you think about that, babe?
Most definitely. That was something that I had to do when I was standing for our marriage, because initially I would get, you know, defeated and hurt if David would, you know, reject me or he would pull away from me or something like that. But then once I started to talk to God and really listen to God to hear what David's heart was saying and what was going on deep inside of him, God was showing me that he was actually lost and that he was really in need of God as a father and in need of healing from his past. And so once God revealed that to me, then I was able to be more empathetic and objective and then actually pray for him instead of getting offended by him.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's good. That's deep. That's deep. And so because we love you guys and we want you to succeed and we want your marriage to succeed, we're going to share with you 8 steps to speaking to the heart of your reluctant spouse. And I really recommend that you take some notes. So pause it if you need to. Grab something to write down. Grab your journal. Grab your man book. And take some notes because these 8 steps are going to be really helpful for you guys. So 8 steps to speaking to the heart of your reluctant spouse. Okay? And some of this stuff is covered in the book. Some of this is advanced stuff. But the gist of this is in my book. So if you got my book, you're good. If not, go ahead and check that out at unmotivated2love.com. Okay, so step number 1 is this. Make sure that you are emotionally balanced. That means that before you try to help an unstable or emotionally unstable person, you yourself have to be in a stable position. Okay? Right. If you're trying to help someone who's unstable and you yourself are unstable, then you're going to cause more damage. And if you're not in a healthy position emotionally, if you're not able to control your emotions, meaning your emotions are controlling you, then you're going to be extremely confused and disappointed when you try to help an unstable emotionally person.
Right.
So just remember, step number 1 is make sure that you are emotionally balanced. Step number 2 is this: come to terms with your own personal baggage, right? We need you to practice being self-aware. So
right.
You got something you want to add to that, baby?
No, I was just saying that was a process that I had to go through because, of course, again, like I stated before, when I was first standing for my marriage, I dealt with a lot of insecurity and rejection that I felt like David was giving me. But then, like I said, as I surrendered to God and I asked God to just lead me through that process of standing for my marriage, God began to show me that I had a lot of things that I still needed healing from my past.
Yeah.
And a lot of things that I was depending on David for that I should have been depending on God for.
And that is so, so true. And it's just a matter of being honest and objective with your own issues, with what's going on in your own life. And a lot of people struggle and they want to point the finger at their spouse and say, well, it's because of them or they're leaving or dot, dot, dot. But really, we all come prepackaged with baggage.
Right.
I haven't met a person yet who came to their marriage without baggage. So get your own mess out the way first, right? And then position yourself to be useful and helpful to your spouse.
Exactly.
But only after you deal with your own baggage first. Okay? Step number three. Let me say this one part as well for step number two. If you haven't understood why you got married in the first place, you need to figure out why you married your spouse.
Right.
I think that's episode number 36. Go check out Why Did I Get Married.
Yeah, we have a podcast on that.
Not the movie with Janet and them, but right, Why Did I Get Married? Because that'll help you to understand how your baggage has impacted your point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's baggage changes the way they see the world. So don't exempt yourself. Be honest. Okay. Mm-hmm. So let's move forward to number three. Number three is this: fully understand the concept of unconditional love.
First Corinthians.
Please understand unconditional love.
Right.
And when I say understand, I'm not saying quote the scripture, because most of you guys are, you know, you go to Bible, Sunday school, you can quote scripture. I'm saying understand it, like exegete it, be able to apply that information to your life.
Right. Be willing to become it.
Be willing to become unconditional love. Because here's the struggle that we find is that most people, even though they know it, they head knowledge know it, but they don't heart knowledge know it.
Right.
And meaning they don't know how to be it experientially. Mm-hmm. They don't know how to apply it in their life.
Right.
You have to be willing to not only know it, but show it. Ooh, I like that.
Good job, baby.
Know it and show it. Know it and show it. For real, though. And if you've noticed something, the first 3 points out of the eight that has anything to do with understanding the heart of your spouse, this has nothing to do with your reluctant spouse. These first 3 points has everything to do with you, right? Make sure that you're emotionally balanced, come to terms with your own personal baggage, fully understand the concept of unconditional love. I would say go study Jesus, go study the first 4 books of the New Testament.
Right.
You'll really be able to see a clear, pristine example of unconditional love. Study Jesus.
And even going to the book of Hosea reading that book.
You dropped Hosea on them.
I did.
I don't know if they're going to like Hosea.
I don't know if you will,
but. I
don't
know if they're going to like Hosea. But yeah.
But
I
it's
like
definitely
that.
Another great example of love that is from a mortal man's perspective.
Yeah. Yeah.
So definitely check that out as
and
well.
And that's a real live, tangible, like, application of unconditional love. Because
right.
You see his struggle.
Mm-hmm.
His wrestling with God, right? Why do I stand? She's out there, and she was a harlot.
Right.
You know, so he's standing for a harlot. I know you can stand for your knucklehead husband or your knucklehead. Well, I'm sorry. That slipped out. You know what, though? I got to be honest. We are knuckleheads. If I could lump myself in there as well, when I was reluctant, I was a knucklehead. So I'm not going to be that nice. Knucklehead.
Hey,
you looked at me like, why are you saying that? No, that brother need to get his life together.
Yes, that's true.
Sister need to come on back home. But anyway, let's go to step four. Step four is this: know and understand your reluctant spouse's past. This, my friends, is probably one of the most important points regarding speaking to their heart, not to their head.
Right.
If you don't know their past, you don't know why. You didn't get that. If you don't know their past, you don't know why. You don't know why they are the way they are. You don't know why they think the way they think.
Mm-hmm.
If I didn't understand that my wife, and this is real, if I didn't know that my wife was sexually molested as a young girl, mm-hmm. right, mm-hmm. I wouldn't understand why she had a propensity to, like, interpret sexual or physical contact as affirmation and love. If I wasn't able to put the two together, I would have misinterpreted her motives like I used to do, right?
Right.
But the reason she had a propensity to believe that sexual intimacy or physical intimacy was equated to love was because of what she experienced when she was a young girl,
mm-hmm.
right? And so you have to understand their past. You have to understand their struggles, the trauma that they went through, right? And how it has impacted their current worldview. This is so important.
Right.
Study their family history. Study their parents. Did they grow up with both parents in the home? Was daddy gone? Was mommy gone? Was there emotional, physical, sexual abuse? Was there neglect? What major traumatic incidents has happened along their way from becoming children to adults?
Right.
What did they go through?
Because it 100% of the time affects who they are as adults.
100%.
And same thing for you.
Yes.
Same thing for you.
Same thing for you. Study your past. Don't neglect your past, right? And again, that's what step number, what was it about baggage? Step number two was about baggage, because your past determines the baggage that you carry.
Right.
So know and understand your reluctant spouse's past. Step number five is this. See your reluctant spouse through those proper lenses. Erase the fantasy that you have of this perfect person that you were supposed to marry. They don't exist.
Not at all.
They don't. Okay? So erase, blot that from your memory. Okay? Because this person, this perfect, flawless person does not exist. That's mm-hmm. your way of coping, right, with your own personal issues. We often want perfection to validate our imperfections. Okay? I'm just going to be real. We often want to be seen and as competent and good so that we could feel competent and good. That's why if you look on Facebook during this time of the year, you can see Christmas trees with boatloads of presents. But they're not telling you that they broke. Actually, some people will tell you they broke and they bought all these Christmas presents, right? Because we want to be seen as good parents, even though we know we got struggles and we got issues. Mm-hmm. We want other people to validate that inside of us.
Right.
Right. And so just understand that, right, see your reluctant spouse through those proper lenses, through the lenses of their past pains. Mm-hmm. That way you have empathy for what they're going through right now.
Exactly.
For their current situation. That way you don't see them as playing with your mind or playing with your emotions or just doing you dirty, because everybody has a past.
Right.
Everybody has a story. And our stories determine our worldview. Okay? So just keep that in mind. Step number six. Look for access points while you communicate. What are access points? I'm glad you asked. Access points are open door opportunities. They can be a little linger, right? They come to drop off the kids and they linger for 3 extra seconds. They could be them coming and venting one time, or them saying something that they normally wouldn't say. It could be an emotional expression. It could
be texting randomly.
A random text message. Look for open door opportunities. Okay? And then step number seven is this. Well, focus.
I wanted to say this real quick.
Okay, she wanted to say this real quick.
So, keeping with access points, please understand that if we are not, going back to the earlier point, if we're not emotionally stable, if something happens before that time and we're still in our feelings and we're in our feelings for about a week, if God opens a door for us to have access to our spouse, this we will miss it.
That's juicy.
So keep that in mind.
Yeah, if you're unstable emotionally, you're going to miss access points. That's why step number one has to do with being emotionally balanced.
Because you'll find yourself trying to just get back at them and say, I'm not going to answer this text because they just did this yesterday.
Yep, you're all in your feelings and all of a sudden you miss an open door opportunity.
Exactly.
So look for access points while you communicate. And then step number seven is once you get good at seeing access points, in the book I talk about pushing and pulling of your reluctant spouse, right?
Right.
And so if you notice that when they're in pull mode, you have more access points. That's when you focus on planting seeds.
And
so
then I also and I talk about one-way communication when it's the proper time in my book. So
That's good. See how the books just kind of fit together like a little puzzle?
Like
David
glue.
And Mandy, like a glove. But yeah, focus on planting seeds. Focus on, and in a minute, I'm going to talk a little bit about what planting seeds look like, because you guys are probably like, well, okay, what do you mean by planting seeds? Just for now, just have it in your mind that I have to make deposits. Now, think about this. When a farmer is planting seeds, he's not expecting to get anything immediately.
Right.
He's expecting that I have to do certain things to cultivate the seed so that it grows properly, right? Mm-hmm. And so I'm just going to say this. Don't expect to get an immediate return on your investment. You got to see this as if you were literally planting a seed. Means that there's going to be a season that goes by where you may not see something. But just know that the roots are sprouting underground first. Mm-hmm. Fruit don't grow first. Roots grow first.
That's right.
And you need strong roots and deep roots in order to get strong, ripe fruit.
And remember, you can't see roots.
You can't see roots.
And those are the things that grow first.
Yes, yes.
So a lot
don't
of times,
get discouraged.
Yeah, so a lot of times you won't actually see that fruit manifest until God is actually digging those roots deep into the ground.
And the one thing that produces, well, there are more than one thing, but the one of the few things that produce a strong roots, healthy roots, is consistency.
Right.
You have to, well.
Water.
Actually, that was number 8. I didn't even, I got to look at my list. Okay, so number 7 is focus on planting seeds. Number 8 is be consistent.
Mm-hmm.
Be the change that you want to see. If you see that your spouse is being rejecting you and being distant and cold, then you got to demonstrate consistent agape love. Be the change that you want to see. Okay. And consistency breeds deep, strong roots.
Right.
Okay. And so the more I can tell you story and story. I have a client that I've been working with. He hired me to work with him twice a week. And I mean, we're seeing like 180 degree turn in terms of success because he's been properly demonstrating consistency with his co-wife. And it's amazing. And it's, I mean, every time we speak, you know, I'm excited because it's no longer we're talking about what's not working. We're talking about the fact that through consistency, through his faith and his prayers, things have changed.
Yes.
You know, and that's so awesome. I love it, especially because it's a husband.
Yes.
You know, standing, which you very rarely see.
Mm-hmm.
So be consistent. So let's briefly run through those 8 real fast, and then we're going to move to what planting seeds look like, and then we'll be done. We'll wrap up. So number 1 was this: make sure that you're emotionally balanced.
Mm-hmm.
Number 2, come to terms with your own baggage. Okay, you're not perfect. You got baggage. Fix it. Become self-aware. Number 3, fully understand the concept of unconditional love.
Mm-hmm.
Study Jesus. Number 4, know and understand your reluctant spouse's past. Study your spouse. We actually did a podcast on becoming a student of your spouse.
Yes.
Know why they are the way they are, please. Number 5, see your reluctant spouse through those proper lenses. So once you understand their past, then you can have a greater understanding and empathy for who they are today. Number 6, look for access points while you communicate. Okay? Be observant. Pay attention. Don't look to receive in the season. Look to give, which is number 7. Focus on planting seeds.
Receive from God, but don't accept that to receive from your spouse.
That's good. Receive from God. I'm glad you added that.
And your support system.
And we're your support system.
Yes.
We got you. Number 7 was focus on planting seeds. And then number 8 was be consistent. Be the change that you want to see. So think about this, guys. If you respond to your reluctant spouse's aggressive, cold, and defensive behaviors without understanding what they are thinking, you will often miss opportunities to plant seeds.
Right.
So you have to pay attention. You can't take it personal. Whenever we give a person a marriage motivation plan, those that are in overflow, we always tell them, make sure that you disconnect their ability to have emotional influence in your life. You can't own their mess. You can't own their drama, their issues, their pain, their fears. You can't. Okay. So let me talk quickly about planting seeds, and then we're going to wrap this show up. So check this out. Planting seeds, right? And I talked about that in number 7, focus on planting seeds. Planting seeds means that you are saying things or doing things that speak to the wounds of your reluctant spouse in a healthy manner.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't understand their past, right, and what wounds they are struggling to protect, then you won't know how to speak to those wounds to begin with. And like what Mandy often talks about in her book is really strengthening your vertical connection with God, making sure that you and God are so close that you can hear from God regarding your spouse.
Right.
I give a video in the marriage motivation plans that we do through Overflow. And if those who are curious about what Overflow is, just go to the website. You'll notice on the homepage, there's a thing that talks about Overflow, or you can go to overflowme.com to check out what that program is. But it's really for people who bought the book, who want greater exposure to us. But just check it out, overflowme.com. But anyway, in that book, Mandy talks about it, and then also talk about it in the marriage motivation plan, that you are the spiritual, like you're the spiritual foundation for your family if your spouse is out of position.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have spiritual authority, and this is mainly to the wives. You have spiritual authority in your spouse's life. And so if you're not understanding what's going on in their heart, God can tell you that because you guys are one in front of God. God considers you guys one. So just like God will give you insight into your own heart, he'll give you insight into your spouse's heart. You just got to go and ask for that information.
Exactly.
And then once you get that information, right, once God transcribes that to you, then you translate that back to your spouse by speaking to their hearts and not to their heads, right? And so, but planting seeds means that you're going to say and do things that speak to those wounds in a healthy manner, that speaks to their heart in a healthy manner. So remember their need to be safe and secure. Remember we talked about that at the top of the show? Well, the more you plant seeds, the easier it will be for them to feel safe enough to be vulnerable with you. And that's what you want. You're doing this to help them to feel more safe and secure being emotionally vulnerable around you. Okay? That's what you need, because when they're emotionally vulnerable, that's when you can plant seeds the most, and that's when you are able to really influence the way they think instead of just the way they feel.
Right.
Right? And so just remember, all this is strategy for helping your stand to be more efficient and effective, but it is also helping them to change their heart. And you got to do that by helping to influence the way they think. Mm-hmm. See, right now, Mandy and I, we're married, right? Well, you guys know that, right? And so we're not in a position where I'm reluctant and she's motivated. We're both motivated. And so now we share influence with each other. Mm-hmm. There are times when, right, I may solicit advice from my wife, or she may solicit advice from me, or there are times when we give unsolicited advice and we allow each other to share that influence on each other. Mm-hmm. There are times when Mandy gives me advice or she says I should do something different, and I may not agree with it at front, but I eventually go with it, right? One example is this new podcast that I'm going to do for these husbands, mm-hmm. right? It's called For Husbands Only.
Right.
And at first I was just going to write a book about it. But Mandy was like, why don't you do a podcast first, then write the book? And I was like, I don't know. And I thought about it, and I was like, yeah, I'm going to do the podcast. So that's me getting influence and changing my thought process by my wife or from my wife. So mm-hmm. thank you, baby.
You're welcome.
But in any case, guys, so we're going to wrap up here, because I know that's a lot of information for you guys to digest. We want to make sure that your marriage is succeeding, okay? And so here's your assignment. I want to give you guys a call to action to do until we meet again on podcast or wherever you guys meet us. I want you to look for opportunities to speak to your spouse's heart over the course of this next week. Mm-hmm. So look for opportunities to speak to the heart and not to the head. Try to plant 2 to 3 seeds a day. So look for access points. That means you have to be intentionally looking for access points or opportunities to plant seeds. Okay? You can't be about you and how you feel. You got to be looking to plant seeds. So right. You get your farmer, put your overalls on, and, you know, get out in the mud, okay? Start planting seeds, cultivate, till the ground, let Holy Spirit do what he do, mm-hmm. and then you can leave a message on the Mend Our Marriage page. You can actually go to mendourmarriage.com/episode46 mm-hmm. if you want to leave a comment, if you want to like this, if you want to share it, mm-hmm. Chat with us, let us know. You know, you can also leave a 90-second voicemail via the SpeakPipe widget on the right-hand side of the website. But we want to know how things are going, right? Tell us if you have questions about planting seeds. Mm-hmm. Leave a comment, leave a question on that. mendourmarriage.com/episode46. And we'll communicate with you guys. Also, before we wrap up, we want you to go and subscribe to this podcast in iTunes, right? Subscribe in iTunes and leave an honest rating and review. And we appreciate those. I think we're at 80-something or almost 80-something rating and reviews right now. Mm-hmm. We appreciate those who have left beautiful messages. I mean, we read them and we appreciate that, guys.
Yes, thank you.
So thank you for that. But yeah, go subscribe in iTunes, leave a rating and review. Also, and this is before we wrap up, this last thing is, if you want to check out Mandy and I's book, you can go to mendourmarriage.com/books. And that's where you'll have access to Mandy's Amazon Amazon best-selling book. It is, so don't get shy.
Motivated to love.
And I'm actually going to put my book on Amazon here in the next couple of weeks so we can get mine as a top-rated bestseller book as well. But Mandy's definitely an Amazon bestseller already. Motivated to Love. You can check mine out. I said I do, but now I don't. But go to mendourmarriage.com/books to check that out. Other than that, guys, we love you guys. We're here for you. And what? We got to wish them a Merry Christmas. So you
Merry,
want,
Merry
you,
Christmas.
Okay, I thought Mandy was going to like sing something cute, but like, we wish you a Merry
Christmas. You want to sing?
No, I don't want to sing because they don't want to hear me sing.
We wish you a Merry Christmas. Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas.
Yeah.
And a happy New Year.
Anyway, guys, we love you guys. We appreciate it. Have a nice, fun, happy holiday season.
Yes.
Remember, if you find yourself lonely, reach out to us.
Yes.
If you're lonely during the holiday season, we're here. We're going to do a Periscope on Christmas.
Yes.
Right? And we're going to introduce our family again to everybody that missed it on Thanksgiving. So we're here for you. But anyway, guys, we love you. We are out.
All right.
Deuces.